Welcome to Lingthusiasm, a podcast that's enthusiastic about linguistics. I'm Gretchen McCulloch.
And I'm Lauren Gawne, and today we're getting enthusiastic about word magic. But first, people often ask us to recommend books about linguistics that don't assume prior knowledge of linguistics. So we've come up with a list of 12 books, plus a few bonuses, including both non-fiction as well as some fiction books with linguistically interesting elements.
Social media is in an interesting state of flux these days, which as someone who studies online interaction, I find very interesting. However, not unrelated to that, we'd like to encourage people to sign up for emails from us in case everything else just melts down.
You can get this list of 12 of our favorite linguistics books by signing up for our free email list, by following the link in the show notes, or going to lingthusiasm.com.
Our email subscribers also regularly get an email once a month when there's a new episode of Lingthusiasm, and this month you will see a link to our linguistics books list if you're an existing subscriber. Otherwise, you will get the books list in the confirmation email after you sign up at any time, even if you're listening to this way in the future. Technology is very useful for things like this.
Our most recent bonus episode was the 2022 listener survey results. So if you'd like to know whether being aware of the Kikibooba meme affects how people respond to the blobby shape and the pointy shape, as well as other results from our survey, you can go to patreon.com/lingthusiasm.
Speaking of books, I've read some linguistically interesting books lately.
And we realized that a common thread between some of the books we've been reading was this link of magic.
And specifically, I love the way that books about magic are also often really linguistically interesting because saying the word and casting the magic spell are so intertwined when it comes to our conception of how magic works. Actually, magic spell and spelling a word. Etymologically, I've just looked this up, and these have a common root.
I had never thought about it, but that is, I guess, not surprising because spells are words.
Yeah, they're both from Middle English spell, from Old English spell, which is a story, a saying, a tale, a history, a narrative, and related to other Germanic languages. And by around the 1500s, there's this magical link as well. Interestingly, and this is why it always pays to look up your etymologies, neither of them is related to spell as in to work for a spell or to rest for a spell. That is a totally different spell.
Okay, this is why it's good to check, because I would have just assumed they were related. But I am delighted that the writing down words spell, the language is older than the magic.
Yeah, well, you know, reading and writing is also a kind of magic. It's a way of preserving words as they're written down.
I also seem to remember that grammar and glamour are related etymologically as well.
That is true. Glamour comes through Scottish.
Ah.
And I first encountered this in another book, Susan Cooper's The Dark is Rising, where you have this magical book of grammar ye, which you read.
Ah, yeah.
And, you know, learn about all of these interesting things, some of which is like where the stars are, which is this sort of very rooted kind of magic, and some of which is, you know, how to make things blow up or go on fire or these other types of magical things.
Definitely a very interesting grammar book. Maybe slightly different to the grammar books that we read in the non-magical world.
It does sort of give me an overinflated idea of what my copy of the Cambridge Grammar of the English Language is going to teach me how to do.
But this relationship between language and spell casting and magic and fantasy means that it's not that surprising that, as well as a link between language and magic and spells in the three books that we're looking at today, there's also a link of educational settings and people at school or university learning how to do magic through language.
So the first book that we want to talk about is Babel by R.F. Kuang, which is this really interesting book that's set in sort of a fantasy Oxford setting where the characters are sort of going to school, learning how to do this type of magic. And the magic there is embedded on silver bars. And the premise is that on either side of the silver bar, you engrave a word. And those two words are in different languages, and they mean something very, very, very similar, but not identical. And it's the slight difference in the meaning, sort of the impossibility of translation. This book has so much translation theory that's just very cool.
There are parts of this book where the professor is teaching them translation theory. And I'm like, this is a lecture that I would have sat through, maybe with slightly less kind of 18th, 19th century like professor, but actually not that different.
Yeah. So this idea that true translation is always going to be a tiny bit different means that when you have two words on either side of the silver bar, the tension between the meanings and the little bit of meaning that sort of escapes translation is the part that creates the magic, which is such a cool idea.
And I like that R.F. Kuang really takes the time to tease out what those translational differences are.
So the first example in the book is a bar that has on one side triacle, which is from French, that I think got borrowed into Old English, and on the other side, the modern English word treacle, which is, you know, not as familiar to North Americans, but it's sort of a molasses-like thing that's, you know, very common in British fantasy novels and also real-life Brits.
I always think of it as an ingredient in like a baked sweet pudding.
I don't know if I have the baked sweet pudding category of item, but I think of like a treacle tart. But the meaning of triacle in French is an antidote for a poison or venom, or a medicine for drawing out or neutralizing a poison. So in English, of course, it's just like, here's this nice sweet syrup. And the antidote is also supposed to be quite sweet, I guess. But it's the tension between these meanings where one of them means antidote and the other one doesn't that makes this bar able to neutralize poisons or infections. And of course, like thinking of examples like this and the impossibility of translation made me think, like, what would I do if I was trying to come up with a bar that had an interesting translation pair on it? Do you have one that you'd do, Lauren?
I have been thinking about this ever since I read Babel, and I think, to throw back to our scales and implicature episode, that I would have a silver bar that had the English word hot and the Nepali word tato, because Nepali has two different words for hot, and one is specifically for hot liquids or beverages. So outside when it's warm, it's garmi, but when my tea is hot, it's tato. And hopefully having the silver bar means that my tea will never cool down when I put it down and forget about it for 30 minutes.
I mean, all of these connections seemed very obvious when they were in the pages of the book, but this makes me wonder, you know, if the difference between the Nepali word and the English word is that it applies to a liquid specifically, if maybe it would make things into liquids? I feel like I'd like to test this magical system out a little bit empirically.
And I do remember there are some very funny situations, or highly dangerous situations, where an attempted friction in the translation has led to not quite the intended consequences.
And from a linguistic world-building perspective, something else that's very important in Babel is that the characters need to have deep knowledge of the language in order to have the feeling of this translation tension that's held in their minds, which makes the magic work.
So I couldn't get away with using or creating that treacle triacle combination because I'm not a French speaker.
And I've just like read, I speak French relatively well, but I've just like read the definition of triacle in a dictionary and been like, oh, okay, that makes sense. But I don't actually know that intimately through my own experience, so I wouldn't be able to hold that in mind.
There's a really, I think, quite distressing plot point. And I should say this book's subtitle is Babel or The Necessity of Violence. So it does give you a sense. This is quite a dark and heavy book about the realities of colonization and the British Empire. And there is one character who, to me, is a really tragic figure who's taken away from one of the languages he speaks very early on in his life. And he still speaks it, but he doesn't speak it really in a way that he feels really confident and immersed in that knowledge. And that affects his ability to do this translation magic.
And the whole theme of the book itself is, okay, well, you know, these English-speaking magicians have sort of mined through French and Latin and, you know, some of the, like, more readily available languages to them and come up with most of the spells that are possible from those. And so they've sort of gone out searching through the rest of empire to, yeah, basically plunder children who speak other languages and say, hey, you can come up with some cool magic based on Chinese or based on another language that we don't have access to. And this, you know, has some predictably complicated, violent consequences.
And this need to have deep knowledge of and really lived the words that you're using in doing your magic reminds me of Carry On by Rainbow Rowell, which has a slightly different magic system and is part of a set of three books, Carry On, Wayward Son, and Any Way the Wind Blows.
Yeah, and in these, all the magic is in English, but there's still this connection to having the sort of deep, intimate knowledge of the language, and particularly the language as it exists in community. So some of the phrases that are used as magical phrases are things like out, out, damned spot, which, you know, can clean things, or into thin air, which can make something disappear, or some like it hot, which can melt something. And at one point, the headmaster in the book explains that the magical students need to keep living in regular society because the idioms that these spells are formed of lose their power if people stop knowing what they mean.
So you have to be really up with your pop culture references and your pithy one-liners to be able to do magic in this world.
And you can get new spells out of a new pop culture reference that people start recognizing, or a new song lyric, you know, things like Carry On and Any Way the Wind Blows are from the Queen song Bohemian Rhapsody. And this can create new phrases that can accomplish magic based on other people being able to recognize them. So that's language as embodied in a whole community of people, not just in the mind of one person, which is this sort of different vision for where language is.
I'd like to think that the reason that people love to crack out Bohemian Rhapsody at the end of a night of karaoke is because the magical witches and wizards of this world have created this as a thing we do to keep Bohemian Rhapsody alive, so that they can still keep making spells like Carry On or Any Way the Wind Blows.
Headcanon accepted. I buy this. But I think there is a certain magic to everyone knowing the words to a song, because you have this connection with people that you might not otherwise know very well, that like, here's this thing that you can all participate in.
And in some ways, memes really do feel like magic, whether it's a spoken meme like a phrase or a picture meme. When you get it and someone else gets it, it just feels really satisfying.
Yeah, so rather than magic coming from this point of tension between two meanings, it's also magic coming from this point of connection of someone else knowing what something means. And that's very different to the third book or series that's on our list, which is A Deadly Education and its sequels in the Scholomance series, The Last Graduate and The Golden Enclaves by Naomi Novik.
School here is a little less stay in the real world than Rainbow Rowell's carry-on books.
Mm-hmm.
In that the school is automated. There are no teachers. The students are just kind of trapped in this magic school that has kind of some Hunger Games vibes sometimes.
Yeah, the premise of this series is that the world is very dangerous. There are terrifying magical creatures all over the world, and they especially go after young magical humans between the ages of, you know, I think it's around 11 and 17, sort of teenagers.
Magically tasty.
Yummy, yummy young magical humans. And so for their own protection, they're put behind the walls of this school, and yet occasionally magical beings will still get into the school and try to attack the students, and hopefully the students will manage to defend themselves against these beasts, but, you know, who knows? So it's, you know, it's sort of terrifying. And the school itself, I don't know.
The school definitely has a personality.
Yeah, the school itself is trying to teach them by sort of recommending books and like throwing books at them and doing other types of, you know, they do like a language lab thing where they have like recorders and they put headphones on and they try to learn bits of languages so they can understand these spell books, which are in all sorts of languages.
And you have to be careful, because as soon as you start looking at a French book or maybe glance at a French poem, the school will be like, you are going to learn French. And it may just serve you French classes for a semester.
Well, and more dangerously, it may just send you spell books in French. And you're like, excuse me, I've really just read one verb and you now think I can just do spells in French? Like, I can't even say these words yet.
It's definitely very dangerous for those of us who have a habit of browsing the grammars of different languages for fun.
Oh, no. Yeah, I saw this and I was like, this would be very dangerous for me personally. But the fun thing from a linguistic perspective is that it's also not just constrained to contemporary languages. So Our point of view character, whose name is L. Higgins, L short for Galadriel, is learning Old English and even wanders into the shelves of Proto-Indo-European spells, which definitely made me sort of perk up linguistically.
I got very excited about this because there is no world in which a shelf of Proto-Indo-European books exists, because this is a language that is the common ancestor language of most of the languages of Europe, all the way through to Southeast Asia, and like Nepali is also part of this family. And Proto-Indo-European was spoken thousands of years ago by a nomadic group. We have somewhat pieced it together through our best guesses going backwards through time, but there are no records of Proto-Indo-European.
And we've pieced together like a couple hundred words out of which you can construct like a paragraph or two as long as you want to talk about sheep.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not something where we have a lot of knowledge to be able to write entire books. But, you know, if this magical school has existed for thousands and thousands of years, then maybe it does have some books that are in this language that we don't actually know anything about.
Unfortunately, Elle just wanders straight past that shelf and we never find out.
Sigh. But there's also something that's very different about the conception of language from this book, and it's part of the sort of themes of the book, mm-hmm. which is the idea of kind of language as trap or language as just sufficiency, where you don't need to know the language in any great degree of fluency as long as you can perform the literal bits of the spell itself and put enough effort into doing so. That's what's going to create the magical effect, which is, again, a third conception of how language is.
I had a real throwback to high school Italian poetry recital competition that my school made us do, where most of the students had no idea what they were reciting, but some of them could recite it very impressively.
And you see this with singers sometimes too, like opera singers will sometimes learn a song in a particular language they don't necessarily speak and just learn, okay, here's how to pronounce it, and here's the general vibe of this is a love song, or this is tragic, or this is angry, and I'm just going to perform this very beautifully, but not necessarily have any ability to carry on a conversation or even say hello, goodbye in that language.
I feel like having a knowledge of the international phonetic alphabet could potentially give you an edge in the Scholomance school world.
Something that I find really interesting when considering all three of these series, all three of these worlds as a whole, is that each of them has to have a theory of what it means to know a language in order for their system of magic, what it means to cast a spell, to work.
And in all three of these series, there are times where spells do not work in ways that are catastrophic for our heroes.
And having those constraints and limitations on what language can do, on what magic can do, is also part of what makes the plots interesting. I guess it's also funny to me that given that spell and spell, you know, spell is in writing and spell is in magic, have the same root, that mm-hmm. writing down the words in none of these cases is the power. It's speaking it out loud that's the thing that ignites them working.
And this makes me very pleased because there are so many languages in our world that don't have a writing system, whether that's because they're one of the many languages that just have an oral tradition, or signed languages don't have a stable writing system that's generally used by the whole population of signers.
Right, but they could still be performed and enacted and presumably made spells of, although we don't see it in any of these particular books, what that would actually look like to be able to sign a spell.
There's no reason, based on the mechanisms that are used, that they couldn't be used to make spells.
And there are ways of performing and embodying words in real life that also let real words have certain types of magic, at least, I guess, effects on the situation that exists in a world.
Gretchen, words can change reality.
And that's not just like, oh, if I describe the beauty of the sky, that makes you notice it more, although that's true too. But there's a specific type of phrases or of utterances that saying them changes something about the world. So if I say, I promise that I will give you $5, the world is now different from before I made that promise.
Yeah, because I'm going to get $5.
Yeah, you're welcome.
I think the canonical example that gets rolled out when we talk about performatives a lot is if you go to a wedding, and this is one of my favorite reasons to go to a wedding, is that moment where the two people are asked, do you take this person to be your lawfully wedded wife? They will say, I do. You have to say that. It is a legal part of a Western marriage ceremony. Different marriage traditions have different traditions, but in a Western marriage ceremony, you have to say, I do, to make that legally binding.
In front of witnesses.
In front of witnesses.
Right. And you sign some sort of marriage contract afterwards, which is also the sort of written part of that performance, but it's the saying it out loud in front of witnesses that also makes that thing the case.
And it's the person officiating the ceremony that says, I declare you wife and wife, or I declare you husband and wife, that makes the ceremony entirely legally bound. And again, they have to say these very specific words in a very specific way, depending on the legal jurisdiction in which you're getting married.
And this gets us to something which is part of the saying the words. Like, it's not enough for you to just say on the podcast, like, I declare these two people wife and wife, because you are not currently officiating a wedding. The power is not granted to you. You don't have two people standing in front of you saying, I do. Mm-hmm. That's not a power that you have right now, even though you can say the literal phrase. Or if you're like in a movie of a wedding, you have not necessarily legally married the two people who are getting married in the movie.
Oops, those two actors are now accidentally married. Oops. IRL because they got married in a movie.
I feel like this has maybe happened at some point, but part of the saying a particular phrase is also saying that phrase in a particular context or under a particular set of conditions, which makes it possible for that to happen.
There's a technical term for this that doesn't require you to remember it for this to work, but I think it's just worth talking about. These conditions are known as Felicity conditions, and I just think this is a very excellent drag name. If you're looking for a drag name, can I recommend Felicity conditions?
New good linguistics drag name. I think it's certainly better than grammaticality judgment, which doesn't quite have the same ring to it.
I just imagine Felicity conditions walking around looking fabulous, trying to get everyone married.
Mm-hmm. Other types of things that you can say that have an effect on the world are things like naming things.
Mm-hmm.
I name this ship the Queen Elizabeth.
I can't. I have tried to. I've tried to walk up to so many ships with so many bottles of champagne, and the Felicity conditions are never met because I do not have this power.
But you do have the power to name two children.
Yes, I have named children. You don't always have to say out loud. We did have to sign some paperwork.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, writing has kind of taken over from speaking in some legal domains.
But if you name a pet still, that's something that's just sort of your say-so. It's generally not,
yep.
You know, you go to the vet and they say, what's the name of this pet? And you just say like Max or Fido or something. And
Felicity
that's
conditions.
My cat, Felicity conditions.
It's Felix the cat, short for Felicity conditions.
Oh my god. And nicknames are an example where the nickname sort of exists because people use it. And it's not anywhere on a written document, but you can say, this is what I want to be called. You know, many online names are names because people just call you that.
Mm-hmm.
And it's you saying, this is my name, and other people saying, yeah, we'll call you that, that makes the name exist more so than the paperwork.
Bets are also a form of performative language. Anytime you make a wager and say, I bet that.
I am going to bet you that someone will actually name their cat Felicity conditions and tell us about it as a result of this episode.
Okay. And if they don't, that is how I'm going to get my $5 out of you.
Yeah. If they do, then you have to buy me ice cream. If they don't, then I buy you ice cream.
Okay. Seems like we all win in this situation. And we've now created a condition in the world that did not exist before this conversation, which is that
right.
We have an ice cream-based bet between us.
And it is up to you, the listeners, as to who has to buy who ice cream.
And in this situation, the conditions are that both of us have the authority to speak for ourselves, both of us have the authority to purchase ice cream should the bet be completed satisfactorily. And so we've met the conditions for this to be a proper performative interaction, and we've changed the world.
If only we knew it was so easy to change the world. And these types of statements that change the world are known as performative utterances. Mm-hmm. And they were first described by a linguist, a philosopher named J.L. Austin in 1962. And some of the examples are also a little bit, 1962. one of them is, I bet you sixpence it will rain tomorrow. And you're like, oh, sixpence. All right.
I don't think we can meet that because I don't think I have access to sixpence.
I don't know if sixpences exist anymore because when, you know, British currency underwent decimalization, now they have six new pennies, but it's not a sixpence coin.
I could probably find a sixpence coin, but it wouldn't mean a lot to transact that bet.
You could buy it on eBay or something, but yeah, it wouldn't necessarily have that effect on the world.
I give and bequeath my watch to my brother. As though watches are the kind of things that are very important to keep in a will and testament.
Yeah. And another fun example of these types of performative utterances is voting. So you can say, like, I vote for so-and-so. I vote for Felicity Conditions as the winner of this drag race. And before the secret ballot was invented, you actually voted by going up to somebody who was recording the votes and saying, here's who I vote for, and declaring it.
Again, this interesting transition between a spoken performative utterance and moving to performing your intention through writing.
Another really fun, well, another less fun type of performative utterance is declare war.
Yes, less fun.
But it's still a type of performative. One country has to officially declare themselves to be in a state of war. It's not enough to merely, you know, do some fighting. There is a legal state that countries are in when they say this is officially war.
And in terms of Felicity conditions, there are a whole set of international regulations and conditions and contexts around how one does that. Since I'm not the leader of a nation state, that is not available to me, which is fine. I have no intention of declaring war on anyone.
I cannot simply declare war on Australia. That's not how any of this works, thank goodness.
No, thankfully.
And, you know, in more innocuous kinds, you can say, I would like to announce that this episode of Lingthusiasm is about performatives.
Mm-hmm.
Or I hereby demonstrate a performative utterance.
Ah, that is nice. I also like that you've used the word hereby, because in English, that's a pretty good little test for whether something is a performative or not.
Right. So if you can put hereby into the sentence, you know, I hereby promise, or I hereby name, I hereby vote for so-and-so,
I hereby bet you.
Right. Then it's a type of performance because you're doing it by saying it.
Another context in which performatives and performativity is often discussed is around how people do gender, which is not necessarily just language.
Yeah. So this comes from Judith Butler's book, Gender Trouble. And they were actually inspired by the linguistics concept of performativity. It's not just sort of a stage or theatrical performance, but it's because Butler had read Austen and was like, yeah, actually, gender is something that you do and that you make more gendered by continuing to do.
And in some ways, every time a person reinforces a way of doing gender by doing something within that culture with gender, you are continuing to shape reality as well. So that's also part of how it's inspired by performative utterances.
Right. So if you give someone a compliment for being beautiful and that person is a woman, then you're reassociating that link between beautiful as a gender type of compliment. If you are complimenting someone who's a woman and you're seeing them as a man, then that's performing gender in a slightly different way of trying, I want to try to de-link these things.
Every time you choose pink for a girl and blue for a boy, you're continuing this Western focus on these colours being representative of these genders for babies, even though these are relatively new ways of doing that, and those colours were flipped only a century or two ago.
Yeah, and it's interesting to see how, you know, gender is something that we receive from other people's performances, but it's also something that we participate in and keep reinforcing by ourselves doing it. And so it's performed.
And so a slightly different sense of performativity, but one that was really inspired by this earlier work from linguistics. The way that words specifically have power as performatives is something we can kind of see in how the way we communicate with words and language and the way we communicate with gestures have slightly different weights in terms of their ability to be meaningful and powerful for people. My colleague Kenzie Cooperwriter has this really neat example of when you're sitting in the emergency row of an aircraft and the air staff come and talk to you about how to operate the doors and whether you feel comfortable doing this in case of an emergency, which I always take very seriously, and they tell you to take it very seriously. And at the end of this, they say, do you agree to do this? And if you don't, we can move you. And you have to say yes. A nod is not sufficiently performative of your acceptance of this role in case of the emergency that statistically almost never manifests, but you have to take very seriously as a possibility every time you fly.
They need specifically you to say this particular thing because you're entering into a type of contract with them.
And so in the context of, you know, at home, would you like a coffee? A nod is a sufficient consent to consuming coffee. In this context, it's a much more serious context. And the seriousness promotes this need to have words rather than just a gestural nod to confirm your agreement.
I sometimes think about this in terms of how technology has also shaped how we perform certain types of things, because there's a thing that people often do in texting where you're performing a particular type of action. So let's say your friend is having a hard day and you send them a text about it. Whether you say something like, I wish I could give you a hug right now, or giving you a hug, or just sort of like hugs you as narrating the action that you're doing. And all of these are not quite the same as doing a physical hug, but they're ways of making it more like a real hug or not, or making it more vivid or more, yeah, closer to the physical thing.
one of the things we've been coming back to is this tension between spoken language having a lot of power and written language not necessarily always having that same power to create, whether it's fictional world magic or real world magic. But it's really interesting, in some cultures, different emphasis is put on writing. So increasingly in Western culture, with the centrality of writing and the prevalence of literacy, you see that signatures are increasingly more important than a verbal agreement. So, you know, it's not the saying, I give my brother my watch, that's important. It's the writing it down in a will and signing it in a way that meets the conditions, which comes from that older verbal tradition, but has moved into writing, returning to dominance as the kind of central way of making it happen.
And, you know, before writing was the dominant technology, you would say something out loud in front of witnesses, and then those witnesses would be the people who were instantiating the contract of, you know, okay, these people have agreed, I've seen it. And then you have the witnesses signing it to say, like, I have seen this person do this, this has been witnessed. As technology continues, you also have this phenomenon of a wet signature.
What's a wet signature?
It sounds kind of gross.
I don't want one.
So this is a retronym for the conventional kind of signature, you know, where the ink of the pen is wet, compared to a digital signature.
Right. Which is not wet because it's digital ink, not real ink. Oh, so I do have a wet signature. It's when I sign something with a pen as opposed to signing a PDF.
Right. The original idea behind signing something with a pen is that your signature is related to your handwriting and no one else should be able to write exactly the same way as you, and you can compare this signature that purports to be from you with your actual signature and be like, look, this person doesn't know how to I sign my name. But in the digital context, you know, if you have an image of someone's signature, you can just put it on another digital document, and it's just sort of there as part of this artifact of things that we have agreed to accept is the form of a contract, but no longer actually requires the person who's signing it to be the person who has that. Like, I have a copy of my digital signature that I just keep using. I don't create it new each time.
But each time you are putting it on a document, that becomes the performance of agreeing to the terms of the document.
Exactly. And an oath, swearing an oath, you know, I solemnly swear to tell the truth, or I swear that this is, in fact, what I have seen, or this is what I saw. That's also related to a performative. You know, I hereby swear that this is what happened last night. And that's sort of part of this contract thing that's a performative.
Oaths are also related to curses in the non-magical sense. If you curse someone, or if you curse using swear language, you are creating a sentiment about whatever you're talking about.
And swearing or using other types of taboo language, those are words that change the state of the world. Because compared to using a more neutral equivalent, they are a way of saying, I am the type of person who uses this highly emotively charged language, compared to a more neutral synonym that I could be using.
This is the reason that we don't swear on main episodes of the podcast, because we know the effect that it can have.
Although if you do want to hear us swear, we have done a couple bonus episodes about swearing that are, you know, locked up nice and safe where kids can't get them. So it's something that does exist, which is an interesting sort of pragmatic choice that we made when we started Lingthusiasm, which was we want this podcast to be something that people could feel comfortable assigning to high school students or playing around their children and not feeling like they have to pre-screen episodes to see what we're talking about. But also, swearing is part of language and it's interesting to analyze. So that's why we put those as bonus episodes.
And knowing the real-world effect that language can have on people is why we're very happy to use swears in a bonus episode, but we do draw the line at using slur words.
Right, because a swear word is emotionally charged, but ultimately refers to things that are relatively neutral or egalitarian, whereas a slur that refers to a particular person and their membership of a group and denigrates them for that is something that, you know, is still linguistically interesting, but is something that we don't want to take on the pragmatic connotations of we're the kind of people who say that about people. And something that's interesting for me is the way that some words have become more taboo. And some words have become less taboo. So the F word has become less taboo even in my lifespan, whereas slurs that refer to particular groups of people, when I was young, some of them weren't as taboo as they are now. So that's also us as collective humans changing what these particular words mean when they're performed. It's not something that exists in a vacuum.
even though I can't make a teacup that keeps my tea permanently hot, thinking about performatives, thinking about oaths and curses and bets is a really good way to remember that language does have the magic to change the world. For more Lingthusiasm and links to all the things mentioned in this episode, go to lingthusiasm.com. You can listen to us on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, SoundCloud, YouTube, or wherever else you get your podcasts, and you can follow at Lingthusiasm on Twitter, Mastodon, Facebook, Instagram, and Tumblr. You can get IPA posters, Not Judging Your Grammar stickers, and baby clothes with Not Judging Your Language, Just Acquiring It, as well as other Lingthusiasm merch at lingthusiasm.com/merch. I tweet and blog as Superlinguo.
I can be found as at Gretchen A. McSee on Twitter. My blog is allthingslinguistic.com, and my book about internet language is called Because Internet. Have you listened to all the Lingthusiasm episodes and you wish there were more? You can get access to an extra Lingthusiasm episode to listen to every month, plus our entire archive of bonus episodes to listen to right now, at patreon.com/lingthusiasm, or follow the links from our website. Have you gotten really into linguistics and you wish you had more people to talk with about it? Patrons can also get access to our Discord chat room to talk with other linguistics fans. Plus, all patrons help keep the show ad-free. Recent bonus topics include the results of our listener survey, our live show about language and gender with Kirby Conrad, and our whole list of older bonus episodes about swearing. Can't afford to pledge? That's okay too. We also really appreciate it if you can recommend Lingthusiasm to anyone in your life who's curious about language. Also, remember to sign up for our free email newsletter if you want to get our list of linguistics-related books, both fiction and nonfiction.
Lingthusiasm is created and produced by Gretchen McCulloch and Lauren Gawne. Our senior producer is Claire Gawne, our editorial producer is Sarah Doppiarella, and our production assistant is Martha Tsutsui Billens. Our music is Ancient City by The Triangles.
Stay Lingthusiastic!